Well, hey, Ron, Real Entrepreneurs. I hope you're having an amazing day. I want to talk to you about five ways that you can turn around a dying business. And that's right, it happens. We're on a trajectory and things are going really well. Then they plateau and then they start going south and you're sitting here and you're going, what is it I do? The first thing I want to say to you is, the question before I get into these five tips is this: do you really want to give this business CPR and resurrect it? Because if you really do, then watch this video. If you don't want to do that, then you should check out some of my other videos where I talk about how to sell a business, how to dissolve yourself from a partnership. If you've got entrepreneurial fatigue and you don't have the energy to resurrect this thing, then I would just encourage you to maybe think about getting rid of it, because this video is for that person who says, you know what, I want to resurrect it, I want to grow it, and these are the things that I'm committed to doing. And guess what? Some of this information I'm going to share with you today comes from MIT, where I am currently a student. So yes, I know some of you are thinking, you're almost 50 years old, girl, and you're still in school. I'm like, yep, I am still in school. And I probably have a paper due as you're watching this video, but I love it. And I love giving you these Ron Real entrepreneurial tips. So go ahead, subscribe, hit the like button, and head over to susansly.com, get your free resources. I would love to connect with you there. So let's jump in to these five things you can do to resurrect a dying business. And the first one is survey existing and past customers and be willing to go and meet with them. Because a lot of times you're sending out a survey, you might be using a tool like SurveyMonkey or something like that, and people just ignore it. I get a lot of surveys. Plus, there's a lot of phishing scams out there. If you haven't seen my video with Rick Jordan, who's a cybersecurity expert, he talks about those, not phishing with a F-I-S, it's phishing with a P-H. And so sometimes we think, oh, I'll just survey people. Sometimes you have to pick up the phone or really figure out a way to go and meet with current and past customers. And so what are the things you're going to ask them? So number one is for your past customers. So why did you stop using my product or service? Number two, if you could give me any suggestions for improving my product or service, what would they be? And then you may want to incentivize them. You could give them an Amazon gift card. Tell them you want that honest feedback. And you also want a representative sample. So 5 or 10 isn't a good number. Start with at least 30 so you can begin to take a look at the trends. For your existing customers, why do you use this product or service? Then what, if we could enhance anything about this product or service, what would it be? Is there a product or service in our, you know, in our company you would love to see, but we don't currently offer? And then can you see yourself still using this product or service a year from now? These are the types of questions you want to ask. A lot of business owners have an ego around their business, and it's your baby, and I get it. No one wants someone to tell them their baby's ugly, right? This is your baby. And ego, which the late Wayne Dyer, who's a friend of mine, used to say, ego stands for edging got it. We can't have an ego around this stuff. It's going to hurt getting this feedback, but it's not going to hurt as much as you going bankrupt or having to fire all your staff because you can't pay them, or paying your staff on credit cards because you ran out of money, right? I know, because this happened to me in 2000 and I had too much of an ego around it. And I didn't ask the tough questions. I was 27 years old and I was terrified to find out why people weren't renewing their gym membership, why they weren't buying more personal training. Breathe. Don't be afraid to ask the tough questions. And this is going to be the first thing. I see a lot of businesses, and we'll use Blockbuster as a case study, that Blockbuster, before their demise, said no one is going to want to use a subscription service. So they don't want to. Remember the red boxes that Netflix originally had? They're not going to want to use that. where did they validate that statement from? Because it just seems like an assumption, which wasn't true. The other thing they said is people will still want to come and they'll want to get popcorn at Blockbuster. Do you remember the free popcorn, right, that they would have? But do you also remember the late fees? Do you also remember the pain of, you know, going there and, you know, it's Friday night and you're like, oh, I just want, you know, whatever movie and it wasn't available. So you had to watch something you've already seen 50 times and pay $29.99. Hello. So they made some assumptions without really surveying their customers. So that assumption is an ego-driven statement and you want to get honest. That's what raw and real entrepreneurship is. Number two is look at trends. So this is what Blockbuster failed to do. They didn't see the trends. They didn't see that people were moving to a digital world. Kodak made the same mistake. They thought that digital prints were a fad. They didn't actually think it was a delivery system. And as a result, they made some assumptions thinking people will still want to use their camera. They're still going to want to print out photos. They're going to want to do all of those things. They didn't look at the trends. Digital was not a flash in the pan. It was something that people were saying, yes, you know, this is something I want. I want digital photos. And so because of those assumptions and not looking at the trends, they fail to capitalize on the trends. So you want to look at the trends in your industry. One of my friends just sold a startup, his startup he and his wife had in the wedding industry. And what their business was allowing you to plan your whole wedding virtually. But instead of like, I've got to go to the florist for this, for the flowers, I've got to go here for the cake. And he brought everything together under one platform and it was super successful. And one of the trends he capitalized on was the fact that people do things like plan their wedding, you know, after work, on their lunch break, they're doing it online. They wanted one-stop shopping. So that was a trend he capitalized on. So are there some trends that you can capitalize on in your industry? The answer is yes. So how do you find those trends? You can go to things like Google Trends and you can type in things just to sort of see where different phrases are ranking. You can also go to a website called AnswerThePublic.com and you can type in a phrase and it will tell you what questions people are asking, but do your research, look at the trends. Another place to get trends is online magazines in your sector and thinking about, okay, there's a trend happening. Am I capitalizing on it? And I'll give you another example. Ketogenic diets. Some companies like SlimFast said, oh my gosh, we're going to capitalize on this trend. While other companies said, it's just a trend. We're not going to capitalize on it. Well, guess what? SlimFast, which used to be those plasticky tasting shakes, completely turned around their brand by capitalizing on the keto trend. Atkins did the same thing. And so trends are there for a reason and trends can make you millions and millions and millions and millions and millions of extra dollars in your company if you can capitalize on those trends. The next thing, number three, is have a solid digital strategy. So if your business has been something that you are, you know, not super strong digitally, and by that I mean ranking in Google, if you aren't ranking high in Google, you're a small business owner, go to agency8.com. That is the agency that my daughter Avery runs along with her business partner, Diana Frerich. Go to agency8.com, get a checkup. They have a Google My Business audit, which will tell you how you're ranking. They're going to tell you how to make improvements in your business. agency8.com, agency8.com. Go there, go get a Google audit. It's not very much money. It's 100% worth it. That is going to help you improve your digital strategy and your ranking. Because if, you know, in the words of Ricky Bobby in Talladega Nights, if you're not first, you're last, right? And if you're not on page one of Google, that's a problem. Number four is rebrand. Shift the narrative around your business. And you've seen some businesses that have done some incredible rebranding or shifting of the narrative. Let me give you an example. So one of those businesses is Peloton. Peloton was a bike company. Now Peloton is a fitness company. And the head of Peloton always said, we're not a bike company, we're a tech company. So now Peloton is known for its yoga classes, its strength training classes. You can go power walking with the Peloton app. You can do all sorts of things. So it shifted the narrative. Lululemon is another company that is shifting the narrative, even with its advertising. It isn't, you know, just putting women who are size zero with an eight pack of abs on their site. They have women of all shapes and sizes on there, and they're shifting the narrative. Victoria's Secret did the same thing when they said, you know, we're not going to have the angels anymore. We're shifting the narrative. We're making our brand more inclusive. So can you shift the narrative on your brand? Maybe there's a way to make it more inclusive, or even to make it more exclusive. So you see other brands as well, where they add layers of higher end products. And Tesla has done a genius job of this. That's why Tesla is a $1 trillion company. Another one is Apple. Every time they release an iPhone, there are what, 6 different versions of that iPhone, and they have a lower price version. I personally think they're all expensive, but I'm an Apple user. If you had told me, this is totally sidebar, if you had told me like 20 years ago, gosh, I had my first cell phone in 91 or 92, and this thing was like a brick, like it was like a huge tissue box. But if you had told me, you know, back then, you're going to pay every single year, you're going to pay $1,300 for a brand new cell phone that's going to fit in the palm of your hand, and we somehow do it, you know? So I'm just saying, Apple's genius at it. Tesla's genius at it. They add layers of exclusivity. So one way you could shift the narrative on your brand is add a higher price product and just do some exploration. And maybe your consumers or past consumers do want a higher priced offering from you. Don't make assumptions when it comes to your pricing. That's a horrible thing to do. You may think, oh, the best thing to do is offer a lower price product, but that you don't know. That could actually dilute your brand and take you further down, right? And the fifth thing you want to do is innovate. So one of the things at MIT, in one of the classes I took, we discussed this whole concept of innovation. And there are different forms of innovation. So a lot of people think, oh, innovation means I am going to create a whole new product. It doesn't have to mean that. What people are looking for is, what is the next thing for me to purchase from you? So innovation can be a brand extension. So it's a new product in an extensive line. And we see this in cosmetics all the time. Kylie Jenner created her lip kits, and then she had other cosmetics that went around that. Sarah Blakely, who created Spanx, initially it was just shapewear for women, and it's shapewear for men. So you can continue to do brand extensions within a product line that has sold really well, because all those past consumers, maybe they've purchased everything you have to offer, but now you can extend that line that they loved, and you can add something more. So start to think of innovation as, I can extend my product line. I can add something to. I can add the what's next. And great companies, and there are so many great companies out there, are always offering what's next for that person. Because once people are attracted to your brand, they have this voracious appetite. And if you don't feed that appetite, they go somewhere else. And going back to SlimFast, another example is when they did their fat bombs, those keto fat bombs that they have. And it was just a brand extension, but that took off and it was crazy. And when they first launched those, people were loving them so much they couldn't even buy them because they kept selling out. So with that, these are 5 tips to resurrect your dying business. Drop a comment below, like this video, subscribe to this channel. Please share this video, tag me. I would love to hear your comments. And if you have a video you would like me to make, please go to susansly.com, submit an idea for me, and I'll take it into consideration, because chances are, if you have a question, a lot of people have the same question. So with that, God bless. Go rock your day, and I will see you in a future video.